Hey, thank you so much for being a part of this show, Purple Quarter Podcast, Rahul. Thank you for inviting us over to your office and we're doing this at your office.
Thank you for inviting me and thank you for coming down.
Lovely. It's nice to be in a new office, Rahul. I can see that a lot of people coming in already. So, congratulations.
We are excited. I think we've grown significantly since we last met, more than a couple of years back. So, we just moved into this new facility. Mm-hmm. Folks have started coming in. We were actually accommodating folks on beanbags there.
Right.
So finally, everybody has a nook and a corner and a good space. So yeah, we are excited.
Brilliant. So Rahul, I'm still going to talk a little bit about you for the people who don't really know you. Well, there's going to be a very minuscule segment of the society now, but I'm still going to talk about it. You've done, if I look at your career journey, you've done larger MNCs, then you moved into a startup. This is your second time stint as a co-founder. Yeah. And you've been part of Flipkart, you know, at that point of time when they were looking at scale, and then you came into PhonePe and ventured into this startup. So tell us, what was it that you learned during this process and what did you actually, you know, bring to PhonePe?
My career has two halves, right? The first 10 years of my career was in enterprise SAN switching.
Right.
This was in the embedded software space, started with Sun Microsystems back in 2000, and then Andiamo Systems, which was a startup in the space, and then Cisco, which acquired Andiamo Systems. So the first 10 years were in that space, and the last about 11 years now, 12 years, has been in the consumer internet space. So really two halves. One thing, the reason that I got into the consumer internet space was because I think the sense of gratification, the ability to actually build something, put it out there, it getting used, and that feedback loop was just too slow on the enterprise or the embedded software side. And that kind of drove me towards the consumer internet space. This was back in 2008, 2009.
Okay.
Right. First stint was a startup that we had, Mime 360. Still extremely fond memories. Built it grounds up to be serving Ghana.com and a bunch of streaming sites as the technology layer. And we got acquired by Flipkart in 2011 and came into Flipkart. A great 4.5 years in Flipkart. It was, like I always say, a university for all of us who were there during that time. And then PhonePe, left Flipkart in 2015 and started PhonePe. I think this time around, we were in a much better position to think about how to set up the company. A great, great set of folks that we could rely on to be a part of the early team, which is huge. And I think that's a luxury, right? As being a second-time entrepreneur and having had a stint at Flipkart, I think that's clearly a luxury, right? And we are only as successful as our team.
Sure.
And we have a great set of folks who actually joined us on the mission very, very early. This was in December of 2015 and Jan of 2016. Mm-hmm. Outside of that, I think definitely a little more gray head, literally too. And what that does is gives you a higher level of patience. We are not necessarily as scrappy as startups generally are. We weren't back in 2016 when we were building for the first time at PhonePe, neither are we now.
Sure.
When we continue to actually scale and push the boundaries, right? We believe in actually building stuff right, taking our time when it comes to our core platforms and our product, and being extremely technology and product driven.
Mm-hmm.
So I think our core DNA goes down to being a technology platform, a technology company, a data-driven company, and we build business on top of it.
Sure.
So I think as second-time entrepreneurs, that luxury of having the right people with you, having the patience and having that, I would say, the cushion to kind of build it out right, take your time with it and deliver a world-class product first, and then look at the business and then look at the operational metrics and the revenue, is something that we've had, frankly. I think that's what we bring to the table through our learnings at Flipkart, the previous startup and the stint. And goes not just for me, it goes for a large part of the team, who have also come from that pedigree. Pedigree less about education, pedigree more about experience.
Sure.
We've seen the first Big Billion Day at Flipkart, right? And extremely proud about it for all the chaos that happened, extremely proud about the fact that we attempted it, and we learned from that to kind of follow on with the next event. And today it's a flagship event that runs extremely smoothly, right? The Flipkart team has kind of nailed it. And there were a lot of learnings. There was learnings in terms of the stack that we have today will not necessarily scale for tomorrow unless you've always future provisioned it, right? So I think one thing at PhonePe that we always focus on is, are we future provisioned? Not just from a scale and performance perspective, but also are we future provisioned from a capability perspective? So whatever my team builds today, they build with a very extensible view, right? Things come down to saying that, okay, we have this solution or feature to deliver. Can we build it or can we platformize it in such a way that tomorrow we can deliver 10x value from that, right? And that's just the functional part of it. Now, as we are doing that, can we actually look at a scale that isn't here and now on us, but will come to it? Sure. So we are big on projections. We share our projections about our scale with the technology team upfront, right? To make sure that it's a continuous process and not event driven. So we try not to, so we try to build future provisioning from a functionality, a scale and a performance as BAU.
Sure.
So we don't treat it as events.
Right.
So that's a very, very big learning that we've had through our Flipkart journey.
Right.
Where initially events, whether it was a Xiaomi phone launch.
Correct.
The exclusives that started at Flipkart. Yeah. Whether it was the Big Billion Day.
Correct.
Right. Whether it was any sort of sales events. Events used to galvanize the company, which was a great positive. At the same time, it brought a huge amount of load in trying to actually scale in a very compressed period of time.
True.
So what we've done here at PhonePe is try to make it business as usual, right? Ensure that we are always forward looking, and therefore all of these events become almost non-events, which is the best way you can actually do it.
Right. I don't know if you remember our conversation when we met in your office in Kormangla. We spoke about demonetization, and I loved what you told me. I'm just going to recall that conversation where you said, "Hey, we're not building for how things are changing in the economy. Like demonetization just happened." I remember you telling me very. It was a blatant truth that you wanted to build technology for tomorrow.
Yeah.
You wanted to build it in depth, right? So there's also this piece that you've written about core technology platform that you want to build for PhonePe. And you also speak about design principles that you want to mention for the platform as well, right? So would you be able to tell us a little bit about how, I know you did talk a little bit about core platform, but can you tell us how has that worked for PhonePe? Versus the, I'm not going to name any other payment platforms here, but versus the others, can we talk about that a little from a technology perspective?
Sure.
I think less about versus because I really don't know how others are building.
Sure.
But I think if you were to generalize it also, the approach that we have taken is not typically the approach most startups, at least 5 years back what we took, is what most startups do take. And I think it's there is a value in that. And it's not easy because it is it demands much more from both time as well as patience by the company as a whole. But we as a team, myself, the engineers who joined us very, very early on, Shantanu, Kaushik, Fanish, Irfan, all of them, architects in the company who pretty much own and run the technology platform at PhonePe, were clear about one thing. Right. We were clear about having a blueprint that separated out what our core platforms were in the company.
Right.
And then what are the business verticals or the technology layers built on top of it to deliver for business. We had a very, very clear distinction. Right. To name a few, there's the core payments platform. There is the accounting platform. There is our growth platform. And there's our risk and fraud detection platform, right? These are really core platforms on top of which most of our business verticals are built. And the approach that we've taken is almost a clear set of principles that we operate with on each of these. For example, we follow a clear shared nothing architecture where we don't allow common databases to exist across the company where you're kind of overloading it with all the data.
Okay.
A design pattern that is followed by many because it tends to actually be the easier paths to take.
Correct.
It tends to actually have a certain level of short-term optimization where all the data is available in a consolidated manner for any of the microservices to fetch and deliver.
Right.
We don't do that, right? Mm-hmm. We have that saying that each of these core systems run with their own databases and they're only fronted by their applications. Nobody reads from the database directly.
Okay.
Similarly, we have a principle around non-caching. We don't create mega caches,
mm-hmm.
right? It's always, again, to have a mega cache mm-hmm. just behind your edge layer so that you can deliver most of the data that is pseudo-static quickly to your app or your website is a design pattern that has short-term gains but creates long-term problems.
Right.
Whether it's about the staleness of the data, whether it's about having integrity failures when it comes to the data itself because of staleness, or it comes in terms of the quantum of hardware that you actually throw at the edge to be able to actually manage this.
Mm-hmm.
So there are some of these core principles that we have actually ingrained in the teams, and it's paid us huge dividends, right? What happens today is that each of these are ecosystems by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
We scale them independently because as we grow, you realize that your workloads are very, very different.
Right.
A workload on your growth cluster could be very different than your workload on the payments cluster and then on the accounting cluster.
Sure.
What we are able to manage is clear allocation strategies when it comes to hardware.
Mm-hmm.
We are able to actually focus on the performance and the scalability of these systems individually because they're not intertwined, they are core ecosystems. And improve them at their own pace. We are able to actually think about externalizing some of these services
mm-hmm.
and create almost revenue tracks out of technology. Now, if you were to follow a design pattern that was significantly intertwined
right.
or was almost a monolith, irrespective of whether you're a microservices architecture or not,
right.
you could be monolith as a technology stack in a company.
Mm-hmm.
And then you never are able to imagine possibly creating business lines out of your technology, right?
Correct.
This is not about AWS, but each of these services by themselves have huge amount of IP that we could actually externalize as an enterprise service.
Sure.
And we are now thinking of imagining our world in that direction, right? Mm-hmm. As a technology group, not as a company, but just as a technology group, can we create revenue lines?
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's already paid us huge amount of dividends. The other thing that it has, the thing that has helped us go down this path is there's a very, very clear demarcation in the company about demands on the core platforms versus demands on the business verticals, right? The demands on the core platform, everybody takes a long view. People may complain about it within the company that it takes a long time to actually develop new capabilities in payments or new capabilities in risk and fraud or new capabilities in growth. But they also realize that when they get built and built right, they're able to extract significantly higher value. So if it takes 6 months to actually build out a new core capability in payments, they know for a fact that for the next year, year and a half, they have the opportunity to actually milk that capability.
Right.
So they've developed a patience in terms of not being top down with dates when it comes to, unless it's a compliance or a regulatory requirement, we try not to impose top down dates on our core platforms.
Nice.
On the business verticals themselves, you can then growth hack, right? And there, what it does because of this model, it forces product managers, business, as well as engineers to try and create more value out of the features that they've already developed versus gravitate towards the next shiny object.
Right.
So I think culturally, we've designed ourselves to operate in this model. So it's a combination of the tech principles as well as the model of operation that has kind of delivered the results for us.
Right. Do you see that any of these, you know, you've actually put them into four different layers, right? If you actually name them right now.
Yeah.
Do you see that these have, you've specifically spoken about what are the positives, what is the outcome? You know, you spoke about dividends that you're getting out of it.
Yeah.
But sometimes single-threaded leadership as well, or if you're looking at it in one specific channel, does also bring a little bit of limitations. Does it have any limitations, Rahul, when you're looking at it in silos?
I think it is less of being a silo.
Mm-hmm.
I think if I were to actually interpret your question and look at what are possibly the flip sides to operating in this model,
mm-hmm.
I think it can create talent pools
mm-hmm.
that are different, right? At
right.
a certain point
right.
that a set of engineers who have been working on a core set of problems at a different scale
mm-hmm.
or performance or infrastructure side might become one extremely comfortable with that, and two, indispensable when it comes to necessarily bringing new folks in, right? So it's a usual suspects problem wherein your reliance on a small set becomes extremely high for certain core platforms in the company. Now, there isn't anything bad in that. I think what we need to do consciously, and where I think we are trying, I can't say we are fully successful, is we're trying to rotate the talent.
Okay.
Get more people in. I think there's a conscious model to actually move people around, get people more exposure. In fact, we have we are very excited about something that we launched 6 months back, and I'll be able to talk more about it maybe 6 months down the line. We call it the PhonePe University, wherein, look, there is the scale that we operate at in the country from transactions perspective, and transactional scale brings a whole different level of complexity, right? Compared to just non-transactional scale, pure web scale versus transactional scale, it's extremely complex. I think the scale that we are operating at and the distributed ecosystem that we have created internally, it's not easy to actually come in as ready-made talent and start contributing towards it. And it's not even easy being in another part of the company that is outside of the core transactional ecosystem and jump into it.
Sure.
So what we've done is try to create a structured program that can accelerate learning within the company so that are this dependence on one core set, because it's not about them being indispensable. They also can get bored at some point. I have engineers who are working on some of our core systems who are excited about facing a pure business problem and they want to also rotate, right? So we need to be able to actually cater to that. So PhonePe University is this program that we are very excited about. We are trying to actually cater almost a structured, project-oriented acceleration of learning within the company, so that we are able to actually distribute the workload that we are talking about from a siloed model to a much more federated model.
Right. What about the data sets? You said, you know, these data sets are not shared as well.
Yeah.
So does that, you know, ruin anything at the end of the day? I mean, when the data sciences team is looking at it, I'm sure they're looking at all the data sets.
So our production databases are completely siloed to each service, right? The abstractions of the data into our data lake and the data warehouse from there has access for the right set of teams, the analytics teams, the data sciences team. So nobody accesses the production databases. So our isolation and our principles apply to production databases.
Right.
Production databases are not accessed by individuals, including engineers. They're all systemically accessed, right, by the application to read and write the data.
Sure.
Now, ingestion of the data into our data lake, then transformation of the data through our data warehouse and the queryability on top of that with all the right rules in place for masking of the any sort of PII data, etc., happens through our data warehousing system, which the data engineering team takes care of.
Sure.
So at least from an access to it, we don't have a problem from the production databases following this design pattern. In fact, I think internally we have a very, very strong culture of data transparency. So we have a event logging system called Foxtrot, which is open source, started as a project at Flipkart, taken forward by the PhonePe team, and we continue to invest in that, wherein every system can generate event data. That event stream itself is available for consumption by any engineer in the team. It could be for troubleshooting, debugging, or even look at data patterns. There's a very nice visualization layer and a query engine on top of it that engineers can use. So an engineer in one team can choose to build his or her own dashboard of events and in another team, another system.
Wow, nice.
Just out of curiosity.
Right.
Right. And the reason we have that is for me specifically, every engineer in the company is a product manager. They need to be on top of the data that their own systems are generating outside of the systemic data, outside of uptime, scale and the error rate, etc. They also need to be on top of the business metrics for their team and also should have exposure to other teams, right? If, for example, the payments team has a view into the conversion funnel for the mutual fund team, right, they may come up with a certain set of ideas that can improve that conversion rate purely from a payments perspective.
Right.
Right. So to encourage that culture, we have actually a fairly open data system within the company. Right. And in fact, We've tried to take that culture forward with Pulse. And see whether we can start contributing to the ecosystem. In fact, Pulse was a natural progression for us based on the culture of open data that we have within the company.
Sure. So let's talk a little more about Pulse. You know, in fact, I think most people are intrigued. I don't know how many people have seen it. I would like people to go and check Pulse, right? It's very interesting on how you managed to put data right out there.
Yeah.
So how did this thought come to you first? And as a subset, I'd also like to ask, does it actually, do people come and ask you, or is there a thought inside the company, hey, are we exposing our technology and IP? So, you know, why don't you?
So I think Pulse has been in the making for a long period of time.
Right.
Not as a product, but more as a vision or a mission, right? I think both Samir and I have been fairly vocal about the fact that what the India Stack team, along with NPCI and RBI, have done through investment in infrastructure as public good, is created innovative companies like us. Right? We've been we are built on the back of UPI, which is public good.
Right.
Right. Any team can, any company can build on top of it with a sponsor bank.
Right.
And we have been able to leverage that, add a layer of technology and data intelligence and build a product of choice for the consumers to achieve the scale that we've achieved, right? So it's always been at the back of our mind that we need to actually give back. We in fact always operated with the model of focusing on interoperability, open platforms. We try never to actually compete for the sake of competing with a very large user base.
Right.
Typically most companies try and chase every other profit pool that is out there.
Correct.
What we've tried to do is see whether there is a right partner that we can work with to enable any use case that we have, any transactional use case that we can take to our consumers, right?
Sure.
Switch is a classic example of that thought around being open platforms. So then the progression was, how do we now give back, right? So Pulse really came out of the fact that at an aggregated and anonymized level, data can be a multiplier factor when it comes to spurring innovation. Just like infrastructure as public good has spurred innovation in the digital payment space, aggregated anonymized data about the payment space at scale, because the scale that we operate at, our data is a reflection of the digital retail payments that are happening in the country.
Sure.
So we want to actually put this out there so that people can come up with new ideas. There could be companies that have a great idea and are looking at, you know what? What is the right amount of digital transaction penetration across the country for them to actually prioritize where should they should be taking the services? As simple as that.
Sure.
Now, this could mean that some company out there is able to prioritize much better about taking their technology solution to market. A GTM is almost equal, if not more important, to the product and tech capabilities of a company. So it could be something that actually makes the GTM decision right for a set of companies. It could actually give significant food for thought for people who are looking at what are the kind of new services that they want to take to market.
Sure.
If, for example, they realize that financial literacy is higher in a certain part of the country, maybe it's time for them to start looking at how to actually leverage that financial literacy more.
Correct.
Or reverse, if financial literacy is lower, maybe there's a company thinking about investing in financial literacy in some part of the company.
True.
So I think what we do believe in that is this data will spur a lot of innovation, will spur acceleration of existing companies when it comes to taking their services to market. And that was the sole reason that we actually built Pulse.
Right. Got it.
Obviously, there was a debate internally about what does this mean for us as a company? Does it mean that we are giving up? Everybody talks about data being the new oil.
Yes.
Are we giving up that big advantage that we've created painstakingly by building this kind of scale? One, the data is anonymized and the data is aggregated.
Right.
So it is a reflection of the market. But deeper data intelligence does not get compromised because of this, right? So I think deeper data intelligence that we can build from trying to actually cater to certain cohorts within our user base continues to be something that we preserve. So that's kind of the middle ground.
Right.
When it comes to technology and IP though, I genuinely believe that outside of scale and performance, today, technology is extremely commoditized unless you're on seriously cutting edge research.
Right.
Nothing, no feature is going to give you a moat for more than, say, 6 months, right?
I agree.
If that is true, then we are really not compromising anything on the technology and IP side of things. What is holding us ahead of everybody else in the market is our ability to operate at scale.
Right.
And at scale, to be continuously pushing the boundaries when it comes to our success rate, our reliability of payments, and all of that. That is really the moat that we have.
Sure.
And Pulse does not compromise that in any way. So I think that's the argument that we made.
Right.
And it was, it wasn't an easy decision. I mean, all the stakeholders, I mean, Sameer and I have had this thought for a while, but every stakeholder within the company obviously had to be bought into this. And I think in the end, once we all agreed on it, we got super excited.
Right.
And then it is to the Pulse team's credit to actually have visualized it as a product. Right. So we have Pulse really caters to three things. You have the pulse.phonepay.com website, where anybody can go in and kind of look at the data in some mind-blowing visualization on the map, right? Geospatial visualization on the map of all the payments data. Like, I was blown away. And the team did a fantastic job. Then we have reports that are out there for anybody in industry to actually take
Bone
a look,
check,
to learn more about the industry itself and the space. And third, we have our GitHub project, where the APIs that are powering the website, all of them have been made available to developers to be able to. And I've had a university reach out to, they're building a course on top of Pulse to kind of look at what open data really means and how it can actually change the landscape of economy in a country. I've had multiple developers reach out. There's already a website based on MongoDB, where all the data has been ingested, and there are simplified APIs on top of our APIs. So we're already having the developer community also engage.
No, this is brilliant. Congratulations to you and the entire Pulse team.
I think it's more to the Pulse team. I think ours was more after the initial thought, it's been more moral support, and they've done an amazing job.
Right. But when you do look at it as an outsider, for example, when I went onto it and saw it, right, there were T2, T3 cities, one would not imagine that would have these kind of transactions, right? I'm sure there would be a lot of collaborations that have come your way, or people come back to you and say, can we do this as well in the city with PhonePe, of course.
Right.
Has that happened?
It's already happening. In fact, we had some very interesting conversation where district collectors and all have come back and said, hey, our district is not doing so well compared to the other district. It's creating healthy competition.
Very nice.
To kind of look at how they can bump up digital transactions. Because the policymakers, the regulators, the bureaucrats, everybody is bought into the fact that digital transactions increase in the country is extremely important from a macro view of the economy itself. And this has created actually healthy competition between them to be able to actually up the game in various areas.
Right?
I mean, classically, Pune being way ahead of Mumbai.
Right.
It's not even a tier one, a tier two, tier three thing. Pune is way ahead compared to Mumbai, right? In terms of transactions, right? It's a lot of very interesting nuggets of data there.
Right. So if I were to actually even, you know, digressing from the PhonePe Pulse a bit, right? Talking a little more about, since we spoke so much about data and how well the technology is built, there's a question that's powering up in my mind to ask you about lending. Yeah. So I'm sure somewhere it would have powered up the entire way to look at lending as well.
Yeah.
Like, I was watching the Pulse, there were a few flickers in my head about 70, you know, people swipe their cards at a petrol station. You know, I mean, not the card, they use PhonePe at a petrol station. That itself made me feel a little differently. And yesterday I was having a chat with someone who said, people are using, you know, loans to pay their electricity bills as well. Yeah, so this has actually got me thinking, have you guys used this data to see how lending will change, or can we talk about that? Because technology, I'm sure, is giving you a lot more info.
I think we've always said that I think lending is definitely something that we will be looking at in the financial services space, right?
Right,
right now, in our financial services vertical, we have been very actively working on InsurTech and building out the insurance distribution platform. It's I wouldn't say it's come of age, but we're very proud of where we've got to in just a year's time.
Right.
Mutual funds and distribution of mutual funds is something that we've been in for a year, year and a half. I think lending would be the next thing that we are looking at. And 100%, I think the whole reason for staying out of the lending side of things
mm-hmm.
has been because we had a very, very clear strategy when it comes to how we want to build out our product journey.
Right.
So we had this, we call it the send, spend, manage and grow.
Yeah, journey, I remember right? this, the stage by stage.
And we've stuck to that. We've stuck to that in the 5 years. One of the things that we're most proud about as a product company is we've never taken knee-jerk reactions based on competition or market dynamics.
Right.
We've stuck to what we believe is our value proposition as a product and a platform company towards our consumer.
Right.
So send money, spend money. I think we have, I wouldn't say we have nailed, but we've got a very large machinery running.
Okay.
Wherein we are able to actually build and churn out new use cases, either by ourselves or with our partners, in terms of accelerating the usage of PhonePe as the product for more and more purchases.
Sure.
More and more use cases.
Mm-hmm.
Now that puts us in a good stead. Like you mentioned, having that fun fact about one person using PhonePe across 70 petrol pumps in the country,
correct.
Right from north to south. I think if we start looking at data and looking at usage, we are able to actually get a lot of what I would call as attributes to building out the right credit score.
Correct.
So I think we are in the process and we are fairly deep in the process of building our own credit scores wherein we'd be able to actually look at folks from, everybody talks about alternate data compared to CIBIL data.
Yeah.
And I think the gap has been very wide.
Mm-hmm.
So there's CIBIL data, which is based exactly on loans and repayment of loans.
Right.
And then there's alternate data, which everybody talks about everything from social network usage usage of various apps.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that divide is just too large to take a leap of faith for new to credit in the alternate data in those terms. I think the right alternate data is really spend data. And we have a lot of that. So I think building out a credit score based on spend data is what we are working on right now. Natural progression from there is to actually then get into the lending space. As you mentioned, I think there is a lot of opportunity. There is consumer lending with buy now, pay later models.
Right.
Now finally coming of age. There's obviously SME lending, which is a very, very large problem in the country that we need to actually solve. I think with the account aggregator license, we'll also be building out an account aggregator stack, which will actually serve not just PhonePe, but will actually serve any FIU to be able to actually start looking at bank statement data to be able to support flow-based lending, right? So I think flow-based lending is going to be a big thing.
Okay.
We will participate in it. At the same time, we will participate in it as an ecosystem builder through account aggregator. For everybody else also to build it, and obviously PhonePe also will be looking at the space.
Sure. You didn't mention crypto because it seems to be the hot topic everywhere. You know, everyone's talking about it, everyone's trying to get into it. Do you see you guys foraying into crypto at all?
I think two parts to it. One, I think the conversation around crypto seems to be much much higher decibel than the conversation about blockchain as a technology.
Correct.
I think BLT deserves more conversation and debate than just crypto. I think there's opportunities to use blockchain technology in the PhonePe platform much more.
Okay.
Whether it comes from creating vaults for a lot of the assets that we are now starting to distribute. I mean, if you look at PhonePe as a platform, it is not just your daily spends, it is your investments, it's your insurance, and at some point your liabilities. And to kind of have a distributed ledger that actually accounts for all of this in a manner that you can completely trust it and actually use it.
Correct.
Even with third parties, an opportunity. Now, crypto itself, definitely excited about crypto, but I think, to be fair, we are waiting on more clarity in terms of the regulation and the policy around it before we actually foray much deeper into crypto.
Got it. I should have thought as much because I think we started our initial discussion about how you guys are focused on being regulated everywhere, right?
Yeah.
So. Okay, my bad. I shouldn't have asked you that. Well, moving along, I think this is one thing that I would really want most of our audiences to, you know, maybe take down as notes, you know, because you guys are also starting a PhonePe University. But a little bit of tidbit about what is it that you want to tell technologists outside, the ones who want to be like you, Rahul? And I think most people want an inspiration, right? They want a role model, good technologists, done well for themselves, created something which is unique, created something which is so in-depth. Would you be able to give a few words, about, talk a little bit about what should they be thinking, whether be it startup or MNC does not matter, but how should they think as youngsters?
I think it's, I don't want to sound preachy, but I'll just tell a few things that I've observed, because whether you're being an entrepreneur and a first-time founder getting into it, or you are working where you are, having an entrepreneurial mindset doesn't mean you have to become a founder.
Right? Great.
And everybody learns things the hard way. So pieces of advice are a dime a dozen. So please take it for what it's worth.
Right.
So I think the first thing is that a lot of youngsters are jumping into the entrepreneur side of things.
Correct.
More because it's cool to be a founder. and it's good, actually. I genuinely believe that the future is should be less about job seekers and more about job makers, especially in a country like ours, right?
Right.
We need to actually create more employment. So more people doing it is great, but do it for the right reasons. That's one of the main things.
Right.
Don't do it because everybody's able to raise money or it's cool to call yourself
the
a
new
startup.
Buzzword.
It's a new buzzword. It's cool to call yourself a startup founder. I think within any company that you're in, having an entrepreneurial mindset takes you a long way in terms of both your learning as well as your growth within the company. Having the entrepreneurial mindset, most important thing is identify a problem. Ideas are again dime a dozen, right? You can get a lot of ideas. Every day, a lot of people have ideas. In fact, within PhonePe also, we tend to actually park a lot of the ideas and question deeply about whether that idea is really solving a problem or is trying to actually solve and exist a problem that is already solved at a different level of scale so that the impact is much wider. So I think evaluating every idea through the lens of whether it is solving a problem and possibly whether it can solve it at scale for India, I think is very, very important. I think the simple way to look at this is because of technology and because of the penetration of smartphones, everybody, or at least very soon, everybody will have a computer in their pockets, right? And all of those computers are connected to the internet. So we've skipped the whole broadband and everybody's on mobile internet.
Right.
Obviously have the highest usage and the lowest cost.
Correct.
So if you put that together, you have an opportunity as a technologist to say that everybody has a connected computer in their pocket.
Right.
And therefore, if there is a problem to be solved, can I solve it at scale because of that fact? I think just putting that together kind of crystallizes your product significantly more.
Sure.
Then I think this one is a little of, it's controversial because it's not really easy, but jugaad and hustle are overrated, especially when it comes to technology, because it always ultimately puts you in the behind the curve.
Correct.
So I try to tell people, do not try and
find a shortcut.
Take too many shortcuts.
Correct.
Because if you really are going to be hitting this out of the park, and if you do it with a non-sustainable solution, you're never going to be able to buy that time back. It's very, very difficult to buy that time back.
Right.
Right. I've seen entrepreneurs who have done this, shown great results. Then you raise money on the back of that. You have a huge valuation and then you have the pressure to continue delivering.
Correct.
And that pressure really means that you're never able to actually take a step back.
Right.
So I think finding that balance, and it's tough, it's not easy. Right. I'm the first to admit that it's easy for me, mainly because I have a kick-ass team. Right. I have some of the best engineers, and I owe it to them that I'm able to take this long view. And it's not easy as a entrepreneur to build a team like that, but to be conscious about that, and to, as you build the team and as you see success, try to invest on technology with a longer term view, I think is something that every technologist and technology entrepreneur should think about.
Sure. I think people watching this podcast would love to work with you, So I'm sure you guys are hiring.
Oh, we are hiring. So do you, we are hiring in droves.
Yeah, so. Great. So we're just going to leave, you know, your Twitter and your LinkedIn handles right there. So people can get in touch with you. Is there any other way that you'd want them to get in touch with you? So please
I
be
think,
happy.
I think Twitter, LinkedIn, rahul@phonepay.com.
Okay.
My email is open.
Sure.
You're looking for the best people.
Right.
And continue to expand the team. So the only thing that I offer everybody is an amazing journey when it comes to hypergrowth
mm-hmm.
and a great amount of learning,
mm-hmm.
right? Focus is on learning. We have some of the best people and we believe that we are still missing out on a lot of outside-in perspective. So folks coming in, bringing that outside-in perspective and the mutual gain is that they're able to actually learn and learn. I think that's the main thing.
And if I can add to what you just said, that most people may not know about you and I can take the liberty to talk about it, is you're still thorough. Still deep in technology, and that's one of the few traits that people who want to become, I'm not saying this is with due respect to other co-founders who are CTOs, but at the end of the day you somewhere lose track and you start focusing on business at large, right? But you are extremely thorough and I think people will enjoy working with you.
Thank you.
So that's something I wanted to share with the audience here.
You're very generous. Thank you.
No, absolutely not. That's the truth. That's absolutely the truth. Yeah. So thank you so much for being on the show, Rahul. Before we sign off, would there be any few last words that you'd like to share? Happy to get them on camera.
No, I think everybody, it's the era of technology.
Yeah.
I think there isn't any company anymore that can claim to be a technology company and be a non-technology company. Every company is a technology company. And I think it's a very exciting time to be an engineer and be a technologist. The other thing I'd like to actually talk about is open data.
Right.
Would love to encourage a lot of people watching this to start thinking about open data, thinking about how they can actually come together as an ecosystem. And Pulse being just one of the models, but there are many models.
Correct.
That we can actually move towards open data. Right?
Supply chain being one of them, the one that you were in.
Okay. Yeah, huge, right? Yeah. I mean, if we come to know about data around the supply chain infrastructure in the country,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure there are going to be 10 other companies that can come up, right?
True.
I think all of us are contributing towards open source.
Hmm.
And India still has a long way to go even in that. But I think we have an opportunity to actually lead the way with open data.
I agree. Thank you so much once more, Rahul, for being here. Thank you.